It's time for my virtual Jericho with John Mayer.
Hello, I am John Mayer. Welcome to the very last My Jericho of the 2020-2021 season. We've made about 60 since lockdown in March 2020. All are on YouTube, all accessible via the myjericho.co.uk website. Do dip in. Some have had in excess of 3,000 hits. Tonight's is a very special edition. It marks the publication of my 41st edited book, yes, that's right, 41, in the last 12 years. Subjects have ranged from the future of journalism and Channel 4 to Brexit to oil in Guyana and VS Naipaul. All are available on Amazon. Tonight's launch is for the BBC at nearly 100, Will It Survive?, the very latest book published today by Bite Size. Is the BBC in existential danger from a government determined to whack it? A very distinguished chair, Sir Anthony Seldon, the former VC of the University of Buckingham and head of Welton School, will try to answer that. But his most important thing is he was the A-level history teacher of the current BBC Director General, Tim Davie. He took him and some Wycliffe students to the First World War battlefields in 1984. Now, that machine gun in hand in France and Tim Davie in 1984 may prove useful for Tim in any coming battles in Britain. But what is Davie's BBC today? Let them explain themselves.
Welcome everybody to this really important launch event tonight on this very hot and somewhat clammy evening, but the discussion on the contributions tonight won't be remotely clammy. They're going to be really pointed. The launch of the Bite Size fourth volume about Is the BBC in Peril? Some think that the BBC is a target for the Johnson government, wants to destroy or severely restrict and limit that. For me as a historian, I'm interested in the fact that Tim Davie is the 16th Director General of the BBC. Surprisingly, not that many DGs have made much difference to the direction and shape of the BBC. I wonder what will Tim Davie do? What does the next few years hold as it comes up to the 100th anniversary. These are, I mean, we always say, don't we, that every single phase and period is pivotal. But I think historians will look back at these early years of the third decade of the 21st century coming up to the 100th anniversary as completely pivotal for the BBC. The decisions taken now will critically affect its whole future. Now, I'm going to be introducing at this point the third speaker, and that is the first main speaker, which is Robin Aitken. Robin, I think, doesn't introduction, we always say that, don't we? Robin, as you know, was an insider for 20 and more years as a BBC correspondent, since he has recognised the BBC is a baleful organisation full of flaws, writing indeed for that well-known supporting newspaper, the Daily Telegraph. Robin, what's led you to change your mind about the BBC to the extent that you have changed your mind? I was slightly hamming it up there. Tell us about it.
I don't like the phrase much, but it's current these days. Lived experience, I suppose, is what set me off on this track. I was a fairly standard BBC reporter. My career was a fairly typical BBC reporter's career. I worked in many different programmes, ending up on the Today programme. And started to have misgivings about the BBC in mid-career, as it were. I left the BBC about 13, 14 years ago, so I've been out of the organisation for a while. But towards the end of my time in the BBC, I began to see things that worried me. One of the first things which alerted me to problems in the idea of the BBC's code of impartiality was its attitude to Europe. Now, I wasn't myself particularly Eurosceptic, but I had occasion to do some reporting on UKIP in its early days. And the attitude I encountered from BBC colleagues was one of great antipathy towards UKIP. I wasn't a member or a supporter myself. This mirrored an earlier experience of mine, which was the BBC's attitude towards Thatcher. I happened to be the economics correspondent for BBC Scotland during the first half of the Thatcher decade, the early to mid 1980s. And there again, what I saw in terms of the news agenda, the way stories were reported, the slant that was put on the tone of the reporting was very hostile to Thatcher. And the problem with that is twofold. One is the BBC should not be taking an attitude like that towards a particular politician. But secondly, that hostility, that inbred hostility to certain people, one might think, for instance, more recently of Donald Trump, the hostility of the BBC towards Thatcher, towards Trump, towards Brexit, actually obscures understanding. It prevents the BBC from fully understanding why these political developments are happening. And I think that the BBC's protestations that it is impartial are just hogwash. The BBC has a very distinct, coherent worldview which colours all its reporting. Now, you might think that you might agree with that worldview. You might be a social liberal who's very pro-Europe. You might be, you know, anti the pro-life movement. You might be pro-decolonization. You might be all of these things, in which case you will find the BBC much to your liking. If you're a social conservative, on the other hand, who doesn't like any of these things, you will find the BBC increasingly difficult to stomach. And that's why the BBC is in trouble, because the BBC has done a fine job in serving half the country at least, are very happy with its service because it tells them exactly what they want to hear. The other half is getting very disenchanted indeed. And that's what the problem is for the BBC.
And it just responding very briefly there, Robin, and some would say exactly the same with our universities, were militantly anti-Thatcher, anti Reagan, pro-EU, anti-Brexit, anti-Trump, indeed anti-Johnson. So there's a mirroring there. Why, despite the fact that it was cutting off its nose to spite its face in adopting that, you're saying, predominant mindset, why didn't it do more earlier to rectify it?
I'm persuaded that the BBC, senior people in the BBC, comprise a sort of clerisy. So a clerisy, as you, Sir Anthony, will know only too well, is an intelligentsia, if you like, which shares a common view. Yes. Within the BBC, I think the BBC doesn't see itself as having a political view. What it sees its own commonly adopted view, it sees it as a civilized thing. It sees it as apolitical, but it's what decent people think. So, for instance, on the Brexit issue, the Brexiteers were categorized as small-minded, little Englanders, all the rest of it, you know, xenophobes, racists, blah, blah, blah. All those very pejorative ideas about who the Brexiteers were. Whereas the pro-Europeans were seen as decent people who were doing the decent, civilized thing. But that's actually, you know, that is a problem. You know, it's a real problem.
Get that. The question still hangs in the air. Why did the BBC not have that critical adjustment earlier? Was it because it didn't accept the analysis, that it did accept it, but it didn't want to change? It did accept, did want to change, but didn't know how to change. Let's hold that there in the air. Robin, thank you very much indeed. Very cogent. Different point of view now from well known to everyone again, also Professor Paddy Barwise, co-author of the very significant Defence of the BBC, The War Against the BBC, published last year. Paddy, academic, long-term defender of the BBC. Paddy, is that what Robin's saying fair? If so, has it caused damage? Tell us, and you have 3 minutes to tell us.
Okay, well, I'll come back to what Robin was saying. I'm going to base my comments initially on my chapter in the book. Now, because John Reith was such an Old Testament character, it seemed appropriate to use biblical language to tell the BBC's foundation story at the start of my chapter, which is called Armageddon: Will the Philistines Finally Destroy the Temple Built by John? And it really is miraculous that the radio manufacturers allowed him to set up the BBC as a public service broadcaster with a mission to inform, educate and entertain, when they just wanted to sell radios. And the rest of the chapter is a summary of the book with Peter, The War Against the BBC, Peter York. Now, when we started the project 4 years ago, it seemed a bit over the top to talk about a war against the BBC. It doesn't now. The quotes, Philistines seeking to undermine it or even destroy it, although they won't admit that, include politicians, think tanks, newspapers, dodgy bloggers, and a few individuals, including Robin, overwhelmingly on the right. And some have clear political or commercial vested interests. Many are economic free marketeers. Others, like Robin, object more to the BBC's social liberalism or wokeness. Now, everyone rightly criticizes the BBC from time to time, but its enemies attack it relentlessly. And some of their criticisms are about money, its scope, its scale, its funding, its supposed inefficiency. Others are about its perceived bias in the way Robin's outlined, especially its news coverage. Now, when we look at the evidence on money, most, although not all, of the criticisms are simply wrong, based on misunderstanding and lies. But with perceived bias, it's less straightforward, more like an inkblot test, with the added twist that everyone thinks the BBC is biased against their own side, like a football referee. Part of the Philistines' case is that the BBC serves only the liberal metropolitan elite, rather in the way Robbins suggested, while ordinary people, real people, feel it doesn't meet their needs. Hence, GB News. Now, I'd be a hypocrite if I pretended I wasn't enjoying the schadenfreude of GB News travails. Some of these are just startup teething problems, which could happen to any startup. But I also think its tiny audience figures actually give the lie to the constant claim that there's a large silent majority of real people longing for anti-woke TV news. We'll see how many tune in to hear Nigel Farage reprise his greatest hits with presumably a few new numbers, but nothing electric, because to try and capture an audience, it's now sort of shifting further to the right. The question for the book, will the BBC survive? Of course it will. The average Brit consumes its services for over 2 hours a day. Nothing else comes close. It's far too popular for the Philistines to destroy it overnight and in plain sight. Of course, there are technology and consumption challenges, millennials, Netflix, YouTube, all of that. But as Peter and I wrote in an earlier John Mayer book chapter, it's the money, stupid. The BBC's real funding has been cut by 30% since 2010, at a time of ever-increasing competition and rising real content and distribution costs. So the Philistines have largely failed so far to persuade the public not to trust the BBC, but if we let them, they may yet eventually destroy it by relentlessly cutting its funding. That's the real threat.
Paddy, are you being pejorative when you dismiss the concerns of Robin and many serious writers and thinkers as Philistines? Are you saying that there is no substance in that central thesis that Robin has presented?
I'm not saying there's no substance in it, although, I mean, Robin rightly says he's sort of cautious about the term lived experience. And sort of Robin, you know, is in danger of becoming the Meghan Markle of these discussions. I think that it's important to make a very clear distinction between the culture of people at the BBC, and if you look at who they are, their demographics, where they're based and so on, they're all graduates, for instance, it would be surprising if they were not relatively socially liberal. And I'm sure that's true. There's a second issue, which is how does that then translate into what gets broadcast? And Robin bases much of what he's saying on his experience at the BBC, as he says, some time ago, which is about the people. And I'm sure he's basically right, although the fact that people at BBC Scotland hated Margaret Thatcher, I mean, other people in Scotland hated Margaret Thatcher. It's hard to generalize from those. You've then got the question of how is that reflected in terms of what gets broadcast? And then there's a third issue, which is how is that then perceived by the audience?
Now, okay. I'm going to cut you there because of time. I just wonder, again, leaving floating there, whether you think that the cliquishness wasn't evident in a number of ways, including the BBC High Command rallying round over Martin Bashir and preventing the truth being got at. The BBC's prime mission is the discovery of truth and therefore dissonance. I'm going to bring in now Fiona Chesterton, our first woman talking today. Again, Fiona's well known to everybody, senior commissioning figure at the BBC and at Channel 4, and her chapter for the book was about the BBC's women problem. Fiona, is it uniquely a BBC problem? Tell us about it.
No. What I was going to talk about today first was the main question of whether the BBC will survive into its second century. I do think the BBC has a woman problem, and there hasn't been, of those 16 director generals, as you know, Anthony, there's not been a single woman, and I think that is That is a failure, and I'm the only woman on this panel. And when I joined the BBC as a trainee in the 1970s, I was the only woman amongst the news trainees, and so there have been huge changes, but the BBC still has a woman problem at the most senior levels of all. In terms of the question of will the BBC survive into its second century, yes, I agree with Patrick. I think there's no doubt it will survive, but will we recognise it in a few years' time? That's my fear. Will it retain what I think of as its most important features, its values almost, even if perfection is way is not something the BBC can talk about in terms of delivering on its values, but those values still, I think, make it worth fighting for. And my fear is there are already straws in the wind that in some significant ways it won't. I'm not talking about the license fee as such. I know others will argue that this is the key battlefield. I can live with that morphing into a household tax or with some subscription elements. What worries me is something about the core of its being. And one of those things is its independence. It is not a state broadcaster. Lots of people still think that it is, but it is not a state broadcaster. Its independence is absolutely vital. And that's why this current row that's bubbling about the appointment as head of news channels of a woman called Jess Brammer, who used to work at the Huffington Post, I believe whatever she may have written on social media, and assuming she was the best candidate for the job, she should, when she carries out that role, be able to park her personal views at the front door of Broadcasting House. Mm. That would be her professional duty if she took that role. If the BBC chooses not to appoint her now, after the intervention of one of its non-executive directors, who just happens to have a direct line to number 10, even if they gloss it over by saying that her social media history was very unfortunate, then a very important Rubicon has been crossed. I go so far as to say the game would be up. I'm not the only one who thinks like this. The media commentator over the water, Emily Bell, wrote a cracking piece about this today. If the BBC does not appoint Jess Brammer now, it will have had a senior, not even board level appointment, vetoed by the government. That would be a straw in a hurricane rather than a straw in the wind, I would say. But let's be optimistic and assume that squall blows over and the BBC finds a way out of this. What's the other signs that concern me? Well, first, the composition of the new board, of which Sir Robbie Gibb is a non-exec director. I fear it now has a look of any number of corporate boards rather than one which has the cultural life of the nation in its hands. There's the chair, Richard Sharp, a city man through and through. There's another city expert, a woman, one of the few on the board, with such a low public profile that I bet nobody watching this will have heard of her. She's called Shirley Garood. Yes, there's Sir Nicholas Sirota with his cultural credentials. The diversity banner is carried by the estimable Lady Tanny Gray Thomson. Really, though, without wishing to be rude, collectively, these 10 people look like the greyest of corporate boards. Maybe that's why at the moment I see a vacuum when surely there should be the BBC's leadership engaging the hearts as well as the minds of the British people. DG Tim Davey has been in post for nearly a year now, and I'm disappointed that he's not yet done this. He seems to prefer a low public profile. He ran for cover when the Bashir affair burst onto the front pages. When Sherman Sharp did an interview rather belatedly with Radio 4, he didn't inspire, shall we say. So why is DG Davey not out there at this most critical time for the BBC making his case loud and proud, as the programmes and services, I would suggest, have never been better? Last year, how the BBC rose to the challenge of the pandemic, editorially and logistically, was magnificent. So in 2021, it should be easier than it was before COVID to defend it. If I could ask Tim Davey one question, though, it would be this. If the public service is assured, why are more and more of the creative staff working for BBC Studios, a commercial offshoot, and how can minority interest programmes survive when the commercial imperative becomes more and more bigger and bigger? And okay, what's to stop a takeover of BBC Studios by an international board in a few years? Dave would probably say it's all set out in the recently published annual report and to some extent in that video. But are you, DG, content that the only news story from that report was about Gary Lineker and Zoe Ball's salaries for about the third year running? Are you happy, too, that the following description of the BBC is on the front page of the annual report published just a few weeks ago? The BBC, it says, is the most used brand in the UK for media. It sounds like a bar of soap. The problem is the BBC's enemies in the press and in the government are winning the argument right now. And strangely, what should be the BBC's jaw and the crown is too often its weakest link. And to that extent, I agree with Robin Aitken. I'm talking about the news operation. I won't go into detail. You'd know it all. But it's not just at the national level. The local and regional news, where there is clear market failure now, is weak and bland. And I can say that as I live outside London and I know what the regional output for the east of England is like, to just give one example. And as Robin says, way too many viewers just don't trust the BBC's news anymore. And finally, just a very short word for Channel 4. Channel 4 matters too, and it's no coincidence that the government's trying to privatise Channel 4 at the same time. This matters, and I would say of Channel 4, if you have a go at Channel 4's obligations, it's a sin. That's what I have to say.
Thank you, Fiona. And I'm going to have to be a bit tighter on future speakers. It's all excellent what everyone's saying, but everyone is exceeding it. And Fiona, just a very quick response. Would the BBC have been different? Let's leave aside other diversities, just with women. 16 male DGs. Ironic, really, that it's so white and so male, and so middle-aged that it's also being accused of being woke. But how, Fiona, in one word or phrase, might the BBC have been better had there been female DGs and more females in top positions?
There's more than 50% of the viewership and the British population as female, for a start. And secondly, I believe in a phrase, emotional intelligence, perhaps. Just a sort of gut feel of some of the issues that the BBC has faltered on in the last few years. Maybe it would have been a little bit different. And also, there's some outstanding women that should have been director general, in my opinion. And
name one.
Jenny Abramski.
Right. Okay. Interesting. Bernard Clark. We were hearing there about.
You're muted. We've lost you, Anthony.
Okay. Am I back? Am I back?
Yes.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Let's just go straight on. I think everybody knows who you are. We'll catch up later. Thank you.
Interesting.
You're muted.
When I think it was Sir Anthony Seldon, the Director General. And that was partly to do with the government. And then, wait a second, before him, there was Sir Hugh Green. Will the BBC survive then, was the question. And honestly, every decade, this question has been asked. I reckon now is the time to take it much more seriously, because I don't actually think the BBC will survive. I can take what Fiona's saying and say the BBC is a spirit, it's a truth, it's a way of reporting, it's something fundamental to the British spirit. I think that will survive, although I'm not quite sure how. But the reason the BBC probably won't survive is because it's in a kind of lame duck conspiracy with the government to run the organisation as commercially badly as you ever could. I reckon there are large parts of the civil service that are run better than the BBC. It's full of useless people who get in the way of incredibly talented people. And nobody's done a damn thing about it. It must have. I once did a calculation. It had 8,000 managers that don't do anything other than get in the way. Now, you might think, oh, well, that's not to do with what the BBC's truth, et cetera, et cetera. It's exactly to do with it. Because the BBC needs to get off this kind of weird belief in itself and realize it's the thing that's running itself into the iceberg. All these people, there are thousands of them. Why? Because it's the way the government wants it to be. It's a civil service organization. So yes, I do believe Boris has seen the point. Certainly Mrs. Thatcher did. Leave the BBC to its own devices and sooner or later it'll implode. It hasn't because the public love it, and they're right to love it. They're right to really believe in what Britain gets from the BBC. But you know, Sir Anthony, my great worry is it's the BBC that's actually going to destroy the BBC rather than the government.
How?
Because it won't change its way of operating. It won't get rid of all these, yes, academics, but mainly these civil service layers and layers of people. That's why Netflix works. And you know, in my article in the book, I tell the story of how the BBC had the iPlayer. It had everything that Netflix had 6 years before Netflix. And it, what did it do? It sounded. And then it sort of had this weird game with the government. And then in the end, the Competition Commission, you know, elbowed it through Kangaroo. But I don't blame the government. I blame these managers after managers after managers.
So was the battle in 25 years' time, will we look back and see the Hall years, the Tony Hall years, as the years in which the BBC lost the war?
No. This has been going on since I joined the BBC in 1968. I mean, I had to sign the Official Secrets Act. What I'm trying to say is it's a civil service organisation, Sir Anthony, and until it changes that ethos, it's not going to deserve to survive. And we need to say that. We need to say it really does need about a quarter of the people, but they all need to be frontline, some special forces, it needs to have that structure.
And in three or four words, your advice to Tim Davey would be?
Fire at least two thirds of the staff, maybe three quarters.
Okay, nothing radical then. thank you very much indeed. Sorry for the lost voice at the beginning. Excellent. Two more perspectives. Leighton Andrews, again, very well known, has obviously been very senior in the media and now a cabinet minister in Wales. So has seen the inside working of the BEEB and also the inside working of government and politics at a very high level. What's happened, Leighton?
Can I just say, I haven't been a cabinet minister in Wales for 5 years, Anthony.
That's clear.
I wrote my chapter on the back of the Dyson report because I was interested in what it said about the BBC as an institution. And I think it's important to remember that the BBC is not only a news organisation, a collection of media services, programme maker, and so on. It is also an institution. And like all institutions, it responds in certain ways to criticisms. 1995 wasn't only the year of the Diana interview, of course, it was also the year in which Lord Nolan reported on standards in public life, establishing seven standards, selflessness, integrity, objectivity, accountability, openness, honesty, and leadership. And that same year too, the journalist and historian Peter Hennessy produced his book on the British Constitution, The Hidden Wiring, which popularized the notion of the good chap theory of government. A good chap knows what a good chap is expected to do and will never push things too far. Well, the era of the good chaps is over, and in many ways, if that means an end to behind closed doors culture, that's a good thing. On the other hand, if it means that anything goes, perhaps in a different way, it's a bad thing. But the BBC is an institution, and the Dyson report really did get inside some of its decision-making processes, some of its accountability processes. and the BBC for a whole series of reasons that Paddy has already outlined, which will cut a good 30% of my remarks. The BBC has been reduced to an extent by austerity cuts. It has come under serious challenge from competition externally, and it's not as strong as it was at the time of the Diana interview. Indeed, it's probably not as strong as when Boris Johnson wrote in 2012, if we can't change the Beeb, we can't change the country. The latest scandal, the Martin Bashir scandal, I think demonstrates something beyond itself. Scandals, BBC mistakes and scandals in the current political culture matter more than ever. And the Dyson report, I think, demonstrated willful blindness throughout the way in which some of those issues around Bashir have been handled. We know that institutions run blame avoidance strategies, and it now looks like some of the journalists or panorama whistleblowers were thrown under the bus of institutional blame avoidance. It's clear they were briefed against externally. It's clear they were warned off internally. So the BBC in this era, an era not just of fake news, let me say, but also of fake norms, an era when the Nolan rules have fallen into disrepute, an era when the reality is that state power is now in the hands of people whose routine justification is the real politic of the people's will. We need a strong, impartial and independent BBC, but the era of the good chaps is over and the BBC needs to be squeaky clean. Will the BBC survive? Well, I'm optimistic. The BBC had a good COVID. It was a key channel for the Prime Minister. It was a key channel for the First Ministers of Wales and Scotland. I think with Paddy, the real threat to the BBC is not extinction, but a potential withering of services, more competition, and a reduced funding base. The reality, I think, is the government will want to keep the BBC, but weaken it.
I should have mentioned that Leighton, of course, is now a professor at the very distinguished Cardiff Business School. Thank you, Leighton, very much. What would you be saying to Tim Davey to optimise the potential for the BBC as it comes up to the hundreds?
I think Tim's got to focus on the BBC's creativity. He's got to focus on ensuring that the BBC is an open institution with a culture in which people are not afraid to tell the truth internally as well as externally.
And who, Leighton, do you look to, DG or other senior figure at the BBC who really got it right, who was outstanding in their era in moving the BBC on?
I think there've been a number of very good DGs in the past. If you take some of the criticisms that Robin was making earlier on, for example, I think John Burt was very clear that the BBC was very late to understand what was going on under Thatcher. I think John Burt was very clear that the BBC was very late to address issues concerned with Euroscepticism. And I think some of the things that have sustained the BBC subsequently, like BBC Online, for example, stem from that era.
Mm. Yeah, okay. So maybe a reappraisal of Burt. Hall's legacy still hanging on in there. Marcus Ryder, again, very well known to everybody, along with Lenny Henry, putting diversity very firmly on the agenda. Marcus, diversity, is it just about BAME? Does it go much wider than that? How well is the BBC playing it?
I think that the BBC needs to restructure. At its very heart, the BBC has always looked at the importance of representing the nations and regions. And in the charter, it talks about nations, regions, and communities. However, you've had the heads of nations and regions, but never a head of nation, regions, and communities. Communities has always been a thing which has dropped off. Now, this might have made sense 50 years ago, even 15 years ago, right? But 2021, I believe that people look at their identity and look at what's important to them, and their community is just as important to them as their nation and region. And the BBC has thrived by recognizing the importance of the nation and the region to people's experience and how people view the world. Right, so here's a few stats. I was born in 1971. The UK census recorded ethnicity for the first time in 1971. That year, the white population made up 97.7% of the population. Right, so the non-white population is just 2.3%. Right, it is now closer to 13, 14%. And in the census, which is going on right now, it's highly likely that it will be higher still. So you're talking about a non-white population, which is roughly the size of Scotland, maybe bigger, right? In 1980, homosexual acts in private between two men, right, was finally decriminalized in Scotland, right? It was decriminalized in 1967, right? In England and Wales in 1967, right? And in 1995, many of the rights that we take for granted for disabled people were finally recognized under the Disability Discrimination Act, right? So to put it simply, how Britain now formally recognizes these different communities, both in terms of law and in general discourse, has undergone a massive and rapid transformation in the last 20, 10 even years, right? And yet the structure of the BBC is still placing the idea that we view our identity and that we view our importance through the prism of our nation or our locale, our region, right? However, we clearly identify, if not as important, possibly more important, through community. And this is seen by the England team taking the knee. This is seen by debates with regards to whether journalists were able to attend pride marches. This is seen through the entire diversity debate with regards to disability, and so on and so forth. So until the BBC actually places the idea of communities structurally at its very core and doesn't see diversity as how many more quotas of black people we can get, how many more quotas of disabled people we can get, but recognize them as being as fundamentally important to its structure and its editorial offering as the nations and regions, they will always be playing catch up. And that's why it needs to restructure. And when it does, then the BBC will not only survive, but will thrive. But if it doesn't restructure, then it will survive as well as it would if it didn't even have a BBC Scotland or a BBC Wales or recognize the nations and regions.
Okay, thank you very much, Marcus. As chair of RADA, do you think that the quality of the drama is as good as it was 10 or 20 years ago?
I think the BBC produces some absolutely excellent drama, absolutely brilliant drama. And part of that is, I think, because of the competition. Rather than seeing Netflix and the other streamers as being a threat, I think that competition is a good thing. And I think that the streamers and other excellent drama produced by the other broadcasters have helped the BBC. The BBC does not exist in a vacuum. It exists in a broadcasting ecology. And if it's funded properly, it definitely rises to the challenge of the other streamers and the other broadcasters.
Okay, finally, Marcus, what is stopping the BBC doing what you've just told us should be done?
Fundamentally, I think what's stopping it is that in positions of editorial responsibility, you do not have the people from different communities in those really important structural editorial positions.
Why not?
Why don't you have them? You could talk about, there were a number of structural reasons as to why, just as you could ask Fiona, why haven't women been able to rise to the top at the BBC? You know, it would be the same reason as to, or not the same, but similarly, black people, Asian people, disabled people, LGBTQ people, have not been able to rise to the top at the BBC. There's a myriad of different reasons, but they are obviously related. It's about social capital, it's about cultural capital, it's about networks.
It still seems ironic to me that an organization that is perhaps rightly criticized for its wokishness, has been so unwoke in terms of distribution of power and financial power and decision making within its own structures.
Okay. The woke thing very, very quickly.
Very quickly.
Yes. Yeah. GB News has come under criticism for not letting being seen as non-woke for not letting a presenter take the knee. Yeah. The BBC not only has that policy that a presenter would not be allowed to take the knee in a studio, currently under Tim Davie, they would not be able to take the knee at a football match. Mm. Right? They would not be able to take the knee at home if it happened to be caught and posted on their Twitter feed. Right? So the idea that the BBC is so woke, it is in many ways less woke in some policies than GB News.
Okay, so that's a good bookend there with Marcus, who's wanting more community, more diversity, Leighton wanting more creativity, amongst other things, Bernard wanting more entrepreneurialism, Fiona wanting more women, Paddy, more of the same, slightly unfair to you, Paddy there, and Robin, a stock take about losing half the country and why the BBC is so much more criticised than our other great national institutions, the National Gallery and the British Museum and many others do not have the same consistent level of criticism. And I think that's an important question. Now, we're going to have just points of view. John Mayer is going to tell us how that's going to happen. Just leading up, we're going to finish with a hard stop at 7 o'clock. Points of view coming in now. This is your disco time. John, tell us how we're going to do that. John, you're on mute.
Anybody of the panel can speak now.
I'm just address Marcus's thing then, because Marcus, you ask how come the BBC in its broadcasting is properly woke and within the institution itself. The idea that it could ever be a black woman director general is just laughable, right? Because you've got to understand there's a BBC that believes in, you know, truth, freedom, in the way that it, and then there's the institution itself, this civil service organization, which is what I'm talking about. Those are the people that need to be swept away, and then we'll get proper representation. But do not ever believe that the BBC practices what it preaches. It doesn't, and it never is going to.
Could I just say something, actually? A lot of people have talked about the values of the BBC, how it's the spirit of truth, the independence of the thing. Actually, I think the BBC self-identifies as progressive, and a problem that a lot of people have with the BBC is that the progress which the BBC has thrown its weight behind has not been progress. This is a wider societal point. It's not just about the BBC. But the Britain that we live in today is a Britain which has been shaped like clay on the potter's wheel by the BBC. It's a Britain awash with family breakdown. It's awash with pornography. The BBC is complicit in the state of Britain today. And that is part of the problem.
I'm going to just ask you there also, do you feel that the other six contributors, chapter givers, have taken your point seriously, or do you still feel that they are missing the point and not understanding how the BBC has lost a significant part of conservative Britain, traditional Britain, and including many Labour voters?
Well, I think that's absolutely true, Sir Anthony. I mean, the problem is that you now have a significant minority in the country, I would say, which is very animated about the BBC and feels that the BBC is in some way an enemy to what they believe in and stands opposed to what they believe in, their beliefs and values. And that's a problem for a BBC, for a broadcaster which is supposed to serve the whole country and for which we all pay. I mean, I think it's Fiona it was who mentioned this Bramah woman who was going to be appointed. Now, you know, there's an inside story there, and it is this, that I think Robbie Gibb, the man who highlighted this appointment as a problem, is not himself someone who wants to destroy the BBC. He is actually somebody who's on the BBC's side. His point is that unless the BBC wakes up to the fact that it is antagonizing conservative Britain, then the problem is going to get worse. In fact, people like me, I consider myself a critical friend of the BBC. I don't wish to see the BBC abolished, but I want to see the BBC remain true to its foundation credo. It has to be fair, and it has to be fair to all points of view, and it isn't. That's the problem. You know, the BBC operates...
Can I just come back on the point about Jeff Bramah? The point I was making is that I don't, I don't know the detail of the recruitment process for Jeff Bramah. All I am saying is, whatever her political background, to get to a situation where it appears that the BBC is being leaned on in a recruitment process, not for the director general or a board level person, which might be arguably understandable, but for someone who's not even at the top of BBC News, seems to me to be one step too far. And in terms of Robin's wider point about the coverage of Brexit, etc., I do think there's been a long-term issue with recruitment into news from a narrower base. I mean, I myself was born in Leicester. I'm from working class background. I went to grammar school, etc. I honestly think if I had come along 20 years later, I might well not have got into the BBC. And I've always been proud of that background. And I think there are some recruitment issues in the BBC, but it's not about Jeff Bramah. It's been a long-term issue with where it's been recruiting from its journalists from.
I'm going to stop you there, Fiona, and I'm just going to ask, with 15 seconds each, some 30 words coming in reverse order, if we can, coming up from Marcus. Again, taking the idea, I mean, it could be a memo for Tim Davey, it could be for the board, it could be for the chair. All of you have a love for the BBC. Some of you are more frustrated with it than others. What now needs to happen? Because if my thesis was right, that the next 5 years, this 17th director generalship is going to be pivotal, what do you think most needs to happen to save the BBC? And by the way, I don't subscribe myself as a student of number 10 to the belief that Boris Johnson government are out to destroy the BBC. They are very concerned about the cohesion of Britain, with possibly Scotland going, troubles in Northern Ireland, possibly returning. The BBC is the glue, a very significant glue that shapes, and maybe morally not enough shaping has been done, but holds the UK together. They're very conscious of that in number 10, I know. Now, let's just go, Marcus, 10 to 15 seconds, and then Leighton.
Sure. Picking up, if the BBC is a glue that holds the UK together, right now, the biggest problem that is facing the BBC is that parts of the UK are drifting apart. Whether you're looking at Scotland, whether you're looking at black people, the largest, whether you're looking at Asian people viewing it less as well, whether you're looking at other parts of the country, right, no longer trusting the BBC, whether you agree with that. So what we need to do is ensure there is true diversity from over the country to make sure that glue really sticks.
Leighton, focusing on what to do, 15 seconds.
I think what to do is to ensure that the BBC is able to demonstrate it is telling the national stories within the UK. And I think it's doing that now, and COVID demonstrated how it was doing that. But I think, you know, preparedness to be honest about the BBC itself, its practices, its ways of recruitment, its own internal stories, as much as the external stories of the UK.
Thank you very much, Leighton. Bernard, 15 seconds.
Get rid of BBC Studios, make that an independent production outfit with global reach. That's the first thing. then bring the BBC down to a staff of about 4,000 of extremely good commissioning people. And we were talking about drama. All the good drama these days is done by independents, and that's the way the BBC should embrace it.
Fiona.
A point I made, basically, Tim Davies should get out there and realise the people he has to convince are actually not government ministers. He has to convince the audience that the BBC is of continuing value for them and that they should be contributing to it.
Thank you.
That's the fundamental task.
Thank you, Fiona. Paddy.
First, it is the money. So stop salami-slicing the money. Secondly, if you're going to criticise the BBC, it does make mistakes, look at proper evidence. And that would apply to things like efficiency, which Bernard has talked about. It applies to things like bias, which Robin has talked about. Look at proper evidence, not just impressions.
Very good. Very clear. Robin.
So I also want to talk about diversity, but I want to talk about proper diversity. So the BBC, to ensure its future success and continuation, it needs to understand that diversity is not just about the colour of your skin or who you choose to sleep with. It's also about political outlook. So the BBC needs urgently to have more people in it who are socially conservative and indeed actually conservative, to ensure that it does not become party pre, as it has so often been in the past couple of decades.
Thank you. I think that was a really good session, a really good hour, full of diverse points of view, full of civilized disagreement, something we're not always as good at universities as doing, disagreeing well. The panelists disagreed, I thought, very well with each other and covered a great deal of ground. Do buy the book. A hero and a wonderful figure in bringing it all together. The BBC at 100 nearly, Will It Survive? Available on Amazon. Thank you very much indeed. I really enjoyed it, learnt a lot. Final word, John, from you.
I'm not going to say anything apart from good night, if you just say good night, Anthony.
Good night, and it is 7 o'clock.
Thank you.